meat, potatoes, turkey. And you'll understand what that is as I go. I've got some handouts here that I want you to have. Before I actually get in, my name is David Brazelton, and I am a beginner wood turner. So I will confess that. And this is my first demo, so I'm really anxious to get through it.
Okay, you'll be fine.
I'm sure you will all support and help me in doing this. But before we get into the actual demo, I wanted to do a sidebar on safety. And it's kind of interesting that you're talking about tops that are coming up. We talked about toys last week. I used to work for Fisher Price as a quality manager down in Murray, Kentucky, which meant that we were responsible for the processes, but also making sure that the toys that we produced were safe and would meet the regulation guidelines for toys. And I'm really encouraged by this club because, like I said, two or three times since I've been a member, about a year and a half, I've heard this discussion about choking hazards. Well, in that packet on the first page, if you flip over, I'm going to talk a little bit more about it and heighten your awareness of some of its aspects. First of all, the CPSC was the regulation department of the government that was set up in 1972, the Consumer Product Safety Commission, to help with the design of products and just to keep inherent dangers from consumers experiencing. And one of the things was choking hazards. It was actually at that time one of the leading causes of death for young kids 3 and under. So that's where all of this stems from. And I've included in here, in this sheet, what the container actually looks like that defines a small part. And I've given you the dimensions. You can buy these things on eBay for $8. I mean, they're really cheap. They're made out of plastic. And I was surprised to see how widespread you could find these. But if you'll notice, it has a diameter, and then it has an angled bottom. And if you can set a part in here, if you look at the very bottom here, the green and red, it fails if it falls below the top surface of that cylinder. If you can position it in any possible orientation, it fails. It's considered a small part. If it goes above that, you're good. Now, do you want to be just right above that? Marginal? Probably not. You want to add a safety factor into this size. And Dallas mentioned about the toilet rope being a good use. That is a good use because it's oversized. It does help. The only problem with it is it doesn't have the bottom one. So you've got to have this bottom to understand how deep it's going inside that cylinder. Now, one of the other things that can be considered is that just because a part doesn't fit in here doesn't mean it's classified as a small part. This is the part I want you to understand. If a toy can break and that broken part can fit into this cylinder, it is considered a choking hazard. That's why a lot of toys are made with snap features that will break apart that can easily be snapped back together. They create a weak joint. So if you're creating toys and little Johnny can step on it and break it, that's a problem. That's still considered a small part. You know, there's a lot of tops that are out on the market these days, or that wood turners make. And I just pulled these off the internet. And I think, you know, some of these are really beautiful works of art, and they probably took a long time to make, especially this one here in the center that has all this offset turning. But if you step on this, how's it going to break? Is it going to break up here? Is it going to break down here? Where is it going to break? You don't know. So if you're giving tops away, you really need to make sure that they are not a small, they're not a small parts to children. But it's probably okay to give to an adult if you say, this is a choking hazard, and you must keep this away from children. So I just want to heighten your awareness about the broken part situation with small tops.
That's great information.
That is great information. I appreciate this. Yeah. I was going to ask, because we were talking about that last month, about baby rattles. Yes. And I found out until last month, this month, I got another baby on the way. And I'm going to make a rattle, and I was going to ask about that dimension.
Sure. And one other thing, when we were testing toys, we would drop them from 48 inches. We'd put a static weight of 21 pounds on it to see if they would break. We would drop them downstairs. We would put them in a freezer, freeze them for 24 hours, take them out, let them sit to room temperature, then put them in an oven for 24 hours, bring them out, and then go through that battery to test. That does some funny things to plastic. Wood is different. Wood is different. But the problem with wood is it's not a consistent or uniform material. So one piece of maple may be great, another piece may not be. So there's a danger there, and I just want you to be aware of it. So when you're making these tubs, design them so that if the bottom broke, it has some beef to it so that it can't break there. Or make sure that it's long enough that it doesn't fit inside that container. You know, I just think for $8 to buy one of these little I have one somewhere. I couldn't find it. I was looking to bring it. I'll try to find it. If I have it, I'll donate it to the club, and we can use it, or if you want to use it for these giveaways that we went to. Meat and potatoes turn. We're going to start this with a survey. How many people here have a lathe? Or have access to a lathe? Well, that's good. How many have ever turned wood? All right. How many have ever been a frustrated turner? There you go. That's about everybody. And this club is made up of beginners to experts. And everybody becomes frustrated at some time or another. And I'll tell you what, a beginner gets a lot of frustration. I got a lot of frustration under my belt right now. So today, what I really wanted to do in this demonstration is talk to you about a new way of trying to teach a beginner to turn. And it's something that I think is missing in the wood turning community today. And I'll explain that through my journey and my frustration. And then we'll end up on the lathe doing some practice pieces. So, when I started turning, all of my turning tools were right here in this bag. This was my first lathe. It's a Craftsman. It does 4-inch diameters thin, about 9 to 12 inches. About the only thing it's really good for is to turn pins. I think that's what it was actually designed for. But I bought this from a friend that he makes guitar amps, and he thought he'd make metal knobs, but it just didn't have the horsepower, and he didn't want to invest in all the other equipment. So I said, oh, I'll take that. Yeah. And I ended up with this, taking a class at Woodcrafters on how to make pins, and I started making pins. This thing only has a third of a horsepower. It uses O-rings as belts. You've got about four positions. So if you break a belt, you can go buy an O-ring, it works just okay.
Pretty good.
Then, going out, of course, you got to have tools. So I bought me this 5-piece mini wood river kit. One of these tools is really dangerous. I mean, I don't understand how you can use it. It's basically just a pointer. But this is what I started with. And it worked. It did work to make some pins. And I don't know what that's for. I'll pass this around and look at it. But I haven't really used these since I quit using this lathe. And of course, you got to have something to sharpen this with, right? So I went to Hartwood Fraser and got me a diamond hone. And I would hand sharpen each of these tools the night before I was going to turn. But you know, life was good. I was having fun turning pins. It did get me into wood turning. But I hit a roadblock. I started attending some of your club meetings when y'all were meeting at Woodcrafters and seeing all the different things that you could do. I started going to YouTube channels. I started reading all kinds of books. The library has great books on wood turning, the downtown library. Our club has great resources. That's one of the main reasons that I joined this club is for the library, because I was checking out 3 or 4 things every week, trying to learn as much as I could. But my interest was growing, and my lathe was nowhere near capable. So I went out and I bought a Delta Mini Lathe, and it's got a 14-inch swing, 23-inch length, 3/4 horse, and it works fine for what I need to do this point in time. But I soon became very frustrated, because I kept reading all these projects and trying all these projects, and nothing turned out the way I wanted it. It was a real problem. I mean, everything that I tried to visualize or try to copy, it didn't come out the way that I was expecting it to.
Oh my goodness.
There's no perfection.
Killer.
So, I started, looking at, going back through all the things that I read and learned, and the next page I have some wood turner quotes that I've collected, and I thought, you know, I'm going to look at these master turners and see what are they telling me that might help me as a beginner learn to turn. So I'd like to read you a few of these. I love the first one. Perfection is a rainbow, always just out of reach. I was trying to be perfect with my turning. I thought I could be it like turn wood like a machinist turns on a lathe, but it just doesn't work that way. Form is paramount as all wood darkens and fades over time. Form is key. Simple forms are never as simple as they look. I can attest to that. With these three here, these are my top three favorites, I think. One thing about creating shapes on the lathe, good or bad, they happen in a hurry. You can make mistakes pretty quick on this lathe. I've got plenty of wood to show. To work and produce any object efficiently, you must have mastered a wide range of technique. That's a key point. Technique, form, you cannot be perfect. In small work, every wrong decision is huge. I like that. To me, the really lucky turners are those whose work is different with each piece, yet recognizable as theirs. That's the experts there. Design is always a challenge. A slight firming or slacking of a curve, an incised line in the right place, the combination of convex and concave curves, all can lift an object from the ordinary to the exception if the maker has the eye for it. You need an eye for form. Form is critical. Simple form's hard to make. You can't be perfect. When creating a turn container, I like to decorate the inside of the piece. When the lid is open, a hidden treasure is revealed, and a secret is shared with the person who opens it. Some of these I just threw in because I like them. The more you understand about design principles, the more likely you are to be able to break the rules and still be successful. Rich Rappin, I think I really like his, Richard, I really like his quotes the best. I would rather be good than different. The craftsmanship is not so difficult if you have put in the time into learning the wide range of skills required to be a successful maker. You have to put the time in to learn the techniques to make the simple forms. Working with wood is like breaking open a geode and discovering hidden treasures. Sometimes you set out to turn something, but yet there's some aspect of the wood that you don't see until you've started turning. Need to change direction. So this is not an exact science. You're just trying to make whatever piece you're making or the wood fancy it to make it look as good as you possibly can. Here's Richard again. If you never turned wood before, I'm sure you'll enjoy it. Shapes develop in seconds, the shavings fly away. And I have a hunch that the ability to remove so much wood so quickly satisfies some basic destructive urge and gratifies the villain in all of us. He has a weird sense of humor, I think. But anyway, the main point that I wanted to say was, from this, you can't really expect perfection. You need to develop a knife with simple form, and you have to have technique. You have to develop the technique. Okay. So, in thinking about that, I started thinking, okay, now how should I learn to turn? And it's really simple. You learned how to turn when you were in first kindergarten. You learned how to print. The process of learning to turn is like learning to print. Think about it. You didn't start writing reports, books, thoughts, paragraphs, sentences. You started with a letter. And your teacher would start you with the ABCs. You first started with a stroke. You learned to make some strokes. You weren't given college rule paper and ink pens. You were given large tablets, large space lines, with a center line as an A. And then she would grade you on your A's, and they would have some mechanically drawn A that was picture perfect. And nobody could replicate that. But when you got close, she'd give you a gold star. She'd give you comments and some criticisms like, well, here's your A, it's, you've got them all really tight together, you need to spread it out. Or this, the line here in the center is not where it should be. The same is true with turning. You have to learn the strokes before you can really chase the forms. And that's part of, that's where we're headed. So, you know, today's beginner's books, and the reason I say the wood turning community needs to reconsider is, I've read all of them that I can get my hands on. And honestly, they all have the same format. They'll start out with maybe a two or three chapters on tools and how to use them. They'll have one chapter on safety, and then they'll have a series of projects that you can go through. You'll do a honey dipper or a pin, starting out doing some spindle turning. You'll do a faceplate turning, maybe a little small platter. You'll do a small bowl. And then you may even do a fake hollow form, where you make a bowl and a top that has a hole in it, and you glue it together, and they show you how to hide the joint. Kind of cool. But anyway, those two, what ends up happening for a beginner is if you try to follow that route, which I did, you end up having a whole bunch of tools, and you really don't know how to use any of them, because each of those projects require different tools and techniques. You need to spend more time practicing your technique. And so that's kind of where I'm at today. So learning to turn is like learning to write. So we need to reduce the variables on a lathe so that we're really getting learning the technique and feel for a limited set of tools. We need to use the same type of wood. This is my opinion. Use the same type of wood, use the same size of wood, so your lathe speed is the same every time. And you begin to reduce those variables and try to get the feel for the tools. So then you need a way to measure how well you're doing. Now, in doing that, let me go back and do one other. So you have to learn to feel the tools, but there's also only three cuts that you're doing when you're cutting. It doesn't matter what tool you're doing. You're either scraping, you are peeling, or you're peeling scraping. Those three cuts. And those are the three things that we're going to concentrate on today. But that's where I think the starting point should be for a beginner. Now, we already talked about all of these different types of turnings. They have spindle turning, they have faceplate turning, hollow form, all of these different types of turning. But most of the places in the old days, if you look at older literature, started with spindle turning, right? That's where we need to start. And if you look, I have some spindle shapes that are given to you, and it's amazing really how many shapes you can make in spindle turning. Now, I don't want to discourage a beginner that wants to really turn bolts. I think they should pursue that. But I think they have to dedicate the time to learning to do spindle turning and to develop their technique. It'll help them get to the place of learning to turn bowls faster. That's my opinion. But anyway, you can see all the different shapes here. I mean, you can actually see vases, balls, big, some vase here. The shape is there. You're learning to develop the shape. It takes a lot less time than it does to make an actual part like that, but you're learning how the tool to make those forms. You just have to grow them in size. There is a process that I took several resources and looked at, okay, how do you develop a skill? We're getting to a point, Hank, bear with me here. But how do you, in developing a skill, there's a difference between knowledge and understanding. In knowledge, if you read all the books, you still don't know how to turn, right? I mean, if I can read how to fly an airplane, I can't fly an airplane. I may can tell you all about what that book said, but until I've actually done it, I can't do it. Turning is the same way. You have to take the time to learn. You spend time learning these techniques. So knowledge is gained through information, but understanding is gained through the use of knowledge. It takes repetition, repetition, repetition. You know, we're not a meat and potatoes society. We like to go straight for the dessert. And I think this is a great skill to learn through wood turning, is to have the patience to learn the techniques to get to the point where one day you can have the dessert. But as you do these repetitions, you need to concentrate on each one. You don't just have to say, I'm going to make 100 of these things and make 100. You need to concentrate on each one and reflect on what you've done. Did my understanding equal my result? If I didn't achieve what I thought I was going to do, then maybe I need, my knowledge is not good enough. Maybe I need to expand that knowledge. I need to talk to somebody and find out what I'm doing different. And you just continually repeat this cycle over and over with anything that you're trying to develop as a new skill. All right. So, based on all of this, I kind of rambled in three or four directions. I got one more thing to talk about, and then we'll talk about that new path to turning. You know, I started thinking about wood turners. And in order to have a path, you need to know where it starts and where it ends. And so I started thinking, okay, how would you classify turners? How would you classify wood turners? Well, first is the beginner. Very limited or no turning experience, has limited tools, or a pot full of cash and has bought the best tools but doesn't know how to use any of them properly. And just has the dream of becoming a good turner. The intermediate stage is a person that has a good foundation of turning knowledge and understanding, is a proficient turner, and has considerable time turning. Then you have the expert, someone who has an area of expertise in turning. Their work is recognizable, and they can help intermediate turners with all kinds of issues. It's the people that you look up to. And then, above that, you have the master craftsman. He has exceptional work in all areas of turning. He recognizes the authority in the expert community of turners. He is recognized as an expert or authority. And they actually break through some of the established boundaries of turning. The problem with all of this is that there's a stage missing. And I kind of alluded to it already. It is what I would consider, in the old days they had the apprenticeship, the apprentice turner. The difference between a beginner and an apprentice is simple. The apprentice has a path to follow to learn. A beginner does not know where to go. He has a clear plan to gain knowledge and understanding of the wood turning process, develop technique, develop an eye for form, and most all the turnings that he is doing is to support that development. So, having all of that, what is our new path? It's simply this. Become an apprentice wood turner. Use the skill development cycle to measure our progress. Practice the basic shapes of spindle turning to develop technique and eye for form. Reduce as many of the variables of turning that you can to help develop a feel for your tools. Only make the projects that reinforce the techniques that you're trying to master. And with this path, life is better. You have a path. So, we're going to apply that new path now. And I'm going to take you through the basic cutting process. We're going to practice the cutting process with a couple of chisels over here, reflect on the results, and then repeat until my goal is close enough. So hopefully we won't be here all night. We're going to talk about the cutting action. And you know, we talk about the ABCs of cutting, which is anchor, bevel, cut. But there's a lot of detail there that it's good to know to help you understand what you're doing wrong. And when you do understand that, it will help you apply that to other tools that you'll try to learn to use in the future. So, we're going to talk about the peeling and the slice cut. Now basically, the first thing you do is you rest your tool on the tool rest. You anchor. And then, you allow your tool to set the bevel on the work surface of the piece. The key point here is this point. The cutting edge is not touching the work piece. That helps you set up your correct position before cutting. Instead of getting a cut in by going in too shallow or whatever, you're bringing this in and you're sliding it down. But the key point is for the cutting edge not to touch. Then you bring the, you slide this down. And as you slide your tool down, it's going to begin, it's going to touch the worked wood surface. That's when the cutting action is about to begin. So, in that movement, you've actually set the tool on the workpiece, and you're beginning to slide it down, and it'll rotate at the same time. At that point, you push, it begin, you begin to see some shavings, just small shavings come off, and you begin to penetrate that wooden surface with your tool. This is when the peeling begins. Your tool, actually as it comes through, you're into the wood and you're starting to see shavings come off the tool. Now, Mike Darlow is the one that I got a lot of this information from. And in case you're interested, the club does have his DVD. It's really good, but it'll put you to sleep. I'm telling you, I fell asleep two or three times trying to watch him. But he has some really good information if you can work your way through it. But one thing that he said is that when you're actually peel cutting, you're not riding the bevel at that point. What you're doing is you're riding the tip of the tool. And that's his distinction. Because actually only 1 to 2 millimeters of this tool is actually resting on the work surface because it's penetrated the work surface. And the same amount of material is also being, the shavings is coming off, you're getting about 2 millimeters on both sides. Now, he goes into this long dissertation about all these forces, but the trick to it is, you gotta balance all of these forces, and that's what the technique that you're trying to learn. Now, I summarize that in three basic types of forces. One is a pinching force. There's a pinch, the shaving is pushing the tool down, the work surface is pushing up, so it's pinching here. The second one is, you have the tool rest in your hand, and this is your support. And the third is that you're getting some resistance from the cutting action, so you're having to push up. So you're having to balance all of these forces. And the balancing of these forces affects the surface quality of your turning. So how do you do that? Well, you have to go back to angles and look at the angles. There's 5 angles that are actually affect your cutting. So in order to understand that, we've got to set up a reference plane so you can see these angles. Basically, you take the tip of the tool and draw a radial line to the center line. And then you take the tangent of the curve here and draw that line. You establish this 90 degrees. That 90 degrees is where we're going to be measuring all of these angles that affect the surface quality. The first angle is actually set by your tool in the grind on that tool. You have no control over that, right? You have control over it, but when the cutting process, that is set. But this also, but that establishes 2 other angles that we need to see. When you set this tool here, based upon this, what you can see from your side is the rake angle. That is the angle of the surface of the tool up to the 90 degrees that goes to, that's a radial to the center. Then, you have this clearance angle. And depending on, these two angles are interrelated to one another. So as you adjust this, the tool, it changes both of those. These two angles are going to help you control the balance of forces of the cut. These two angles are going to determine the amount of penetration of the tool as well into the wood. And these two angles determine the thickness of the shavings coming off. So, these two angles are pretty critical for really setting one of the major influences of getting a good turned quality surface. Hang in there, we're almost done with this. So, what that means is, more rake, meaning that you take it here and you pivot this tool down, means that you have less tool tip penetration into the wood, you have thinner shavings, you have less wood being removed, and you have a better, smoother surface. That's, if you've ever done this, this is just articulating what you really learn when you're moving this tool up and down. But if you know these points and understand what it's doing, I think it'll help you in trying to figure out what's going wrong with your turn. And then, of course, if you have less rake, you have more clearance. And so you brought the tool, you brought it up, you've got more clearance, you've got thicker shavings coming off, you penetrated deeper into the wood, and you have a rougher surface finish. So these are three of the five angles. There's actually two more that you have to be concerned with. And that is, one is slicing, that's peeling. This is slicing. Now you can slice, if this was the tool edge and you were to put this up against here, you could slice like that. But you have other angles. You could slice like this. But the key point is that the best slicing is in between. And what happens is it reduces the amount of shaving that's actually being shaved, but it also creates a smoother surface finish. The other angle is rotation. So you can rotate the tool. So you rotate the tool, and that also, it digs in a little deeper into the wood and helps with the size of the shaving that's coming off. So you have to learn to control three things in your technique. You need to learn to control the up and down motion of the tool. You need to understand how to slice and rotate to get the best cut. So you can break these things down into those three areas if you're having trouble cutting to figure out, and we're going to do some of that here in just a minute, but to figure out what your problems are and maybe help solve, make a better part. So now we've got our knowledge, let's go do some turning. The roughing gouge, it's a pretty good tool. It's a good tool to start with. The thing that makes it different is that it has a deep channel. Most of you guys know this. And the angle of cut here, I have this one about 35 degrees. But this tool you can do a lot with. You know, a lot of people just use these tools and to rough down lumber, to get it from square to round. But this tool can actually do a lot. And especially in a beginner's hand, it's a good training tool because you can understand the peel, slice, cutting. And if it's because it's so large on this piece of equipment, on this tool. You can do scraping cuts with this, you can do a peel slice cut with this, you can do a push cut with this, and you can even do a skew cut with this on the side. I'm going to show you that here in a minute. Now, before we start though, we need to know what length speed to go on this thing. And how do you determine that? In your handout, I've given you some information, and I found various types of, I find different speeds. I found different charts that have different speeds. To resolve that, I just use a formula that I have at the bottom that I think is the easiest to use. But anyway, when you're roughing from square to round, you want to do it safely. The equation is the diameter times the RPM equals 6,000 to 9,000. That 6,000 to 9,000 is just an index number. It has no relation or physical meaning to anything, but this is something that I guess turners over time have established as a safe range to turn wood to set your speed. So all you do is you take, you can use your minimum RPM at the 6,000, and use the maximum RPM, calculating it with the 9,000. So, you can just take the 6 and divide it by your diameter, and then multiply that by 1,000, and that gives you your RPM. Right now, this is 4 3/4 inches across diagonal. I'm using a big piece here for demonstration, but I've also decided that maybe this is a good size for a beginner to start with, and I'll tell you why when we get into another part of the turn. But for this one, basically, if you calculate it out, I think it's like 1260 RPM is the magic number to start with on the low end for roughing, because that's across the diameter. But what happens if I go to 25% less than that? Well, we start out at 1,000. What happens?
We're going to find out.
And it really has to do with surface quality. I'll just give you the answer. Do I need to do something?
You're fine.
Better.
Okay. Now, I'm not used to this lathe, but I couldn't wait to try it. Now, I have just a piece of old, cheap, white pine stock, and I bought this at Menards, cut them down. So it's not going to turn like wet wood, but for learning this type of turning, I think it's okay because I don't want to chew up a lot of good wood. And before I get started, I need to put on some safety stuff here. Only wear this because I hate those chips that are in the shirt. But this isn't going to zip, so we're just going to leave it. All right. So, I'm going to do a peel. I'm going to do the anchor bevel cut. And what I'm going to do is, when you're doing gouge, you all know that you don't start on this side because you'll chip the wood on this. You need to start a little offset. So I'm going to try this out. I'm riding the bevel, bringing it down until it cuts, and then I'm going to slide. Slide the bevel, tilt it, penetrate, push in, slide. This is only one way to do this. Oops. Now see, at that point, I was not riding the bevel. I put the edge right into the wood. That's what you want to prevent. You want to ride that bevel, bring it down. Now, I'm going at 1,000 RPM. And I'm eating this. I haven't turned enough, but you can see the areas, how rough this is where we're turning. I'm sure you've all seen this before. So it's really important to get your lathe speed up. And the trick to this is, when you're turning bows, you do turn at a lot slower speed. Spindle turning, you turn a lot faster. But let's bring it up to the 12. There we go. Let's see if we get any better surface finish. It's a little better. I don't know if you can see that.
Looks better.
It looks better.
A lot better.
But you know what? We could go faster. And that's what we're going to do. Because I can go up to 9,000. Not 9,000 RPM. I'm going to go about 1,800 actually. My chips are a lot finer, right? Now, there's something I can do here too. It's called the feed. It's how fast I'm traveling here. If I travel really fast, I'm going to get ripples. See the ripples. Traveling too fast, moving too fast. If you're having trouble getting smoothness, you might be going too fast. a little better, but not great. It still won't get you a really good finish. Well, let me take that back. Change that in a minute. Well, there's another, the push cut that I want to demonstrate too, and that's where you just push it in. And this will take out a lot of material really quick. And you got too close to the end. It doesn't give a good finish, but if you want to take out a lot of material really quick, that's one way to use this tool. Now let's clean it up a little bit. So we've shown peel and slice. We've shown the push. We can also use this kind of like a parting tool. You can actually make your, let me pull this down a little bit. You need to make this for a chuck. You can take the end of this. Trick to this is this point, this side needs to be really sharp. And I'm going to only use that side of it and hog down part of that to get a, using a push cut, but treatment tender. Do the other side too. The only thing about this, it leaves the surface quality on this side not so good. And it's just like a parting tool. It does the same thing. So, that's pretty much the skew. The roughing gouge.
David, one yes. thing with that roughing gouge, if you hold it so that it's instead of the very center of the bottom of the cutting surface, if you hold it so it's like nearly 90 degrees from that, you can bring that edge across, and it cuts really well that way also.
Okay. Oh, well, let's give it a shot. Coming in 90 degrees?
I don't mean that the tool is 90 degrees. I mean that the cutting surface, instead of at the bottom round of the surface,
that's the skew portion. That's right. I'm sorry about that. You can do that. Let me change my tool rest here. I meant to show that.
Your tool rest is probably a little lower.
Yeah. I like, now when I'm doing this though, I like for it to be a little high. Just like a skew, right? But is that right? I'm learning too, so. Yeah. So I'm going to use this edge like a skew. We'll rub the bevel, grind the cut. I'm not used to this long. Thanks for pointing that out, because I meant to show that. Okay. That looks a little better, but I'm still getting some tear out. And probably the reason is because I'm still learning to grind these tools and get them to sharp edge on them, so I'm going to have to take part of the blame there. But as you progress, the next thing is the skew. You know, I have an oval skew. I bought this before I was introduced to Alan Lancer, saying he hates the oval skew, it needs to be a flat skew. But I bought this because the knowledge that I had at the time said that this was the tool to have.
I did the same thing.
And I'm not going to go out and buy another tool until I learn to use this. I'm stuck.
Well, they're a lot harder to use than a flat skew.
I think the reason they're harder is because they're harder to sharpen. Because it wants to rotate as you're trying to sharpen this tool. If you look, I want to talk a little bit about the design of this tool. And on the very back page, I have here Alan Batty's and Alan Lancer's recommendation for the skew. Now, Alan, both of them agree that 70 degrees from this point to this point, measured from here, is the angle that you want these two points to be at, the slope. But where they disagree on is on the angle of grind. And Alan Batty says that he looks at it from the point of softwood and hardwood. Softer wood, you can use a finer point. He uses 25 degrees. Hardwood, that's too soft of a point. You're going to dull your edge really fast. So he recommends like 55 degrees on a really hard lumber. And then he has 40 degrees in the middle. And that's his recommended grind to start with. Alan Lancer, he does basically the same thing, but he says to use 1.5 times the material thickness is what your slope should be. I really like Alan Batty's. Intuitively, I like his. And so that's what I'm sticking with. I'm using the 40 degree grind. Actually, I got 35 degrees. I'm having a hard time getting 40 on this one. But the thing I do like about Alan is he does a flat and a curve. But he maintains the two points at 70 degrees. And this gives you a lot of versatility with the skew. So he has tons of stuff that you can do with the skew. And I'm not going to get into all of that, but I do have a handout that I'll give you that talks about some of that stuff. But one nice thing about the skew is you will not find any tool that makes a nicer surface on a spindle than this. Is that a fair statement from my experience? Well, I'm going to attempt it. Let's see. Now, honestly, I'm down to round now, so my speed needs to go up. So, I'm going to go up to about 2,700 RPM. If I can figure out which direction to go. There we go.
Clockwise.
There we go. Close enough. Now this tool is not forgiving. I have many catches with this, and you'll probably see one today. So maybe you'll get to see one and know what to expect if you try this. The planing is a good place to start with the skew. And when you cut with it on planing cuts, you cut, this is called the toe and the heel of the tool. The short end is the heel. When you're planing, you're going to be cutting from the middle toward the heel. The main thing you do not want to do is let this corner be part of the cutting edge. You'll get a catch. And you want to make sure that you concentrate and watch where that cutting is at all times. This is one of the good reasons. This is the reason that I like this, because it forces you to concentrate on what you're doing.
So I'm going to rub the bevel. I'm going to turn it a little bit. There's still some tool marks, but honestly, for a beginner, that's a pretty good finish. Now, once you learn to go this direction, you need to learn to go back the other direction. Can't be a one-handed turner. I'm not doing so well there. One thing that's really important with the skew, you cannot have a firm grip on it. You have to treat it lightly. You have to have a good anchor, a firm anchor on the tool rest, but you've got to lightly hold it and regulate it in order to get a good cut. And I'm making a mess of this. I'm getting some vibration too. Those shavings are a lot different than what I got before you see on the floor. Yes. This is really a nice tool to learn. I keep a bucket, and I keep all my sawdust in here in case I want to use it for finishing, but also it's good for your tools. It doesn't build a finish. That's an old trick that someone showed here in the club several years ago. So, I want to clean this up. Next, that's our A. We've learned to make a round and we've learned to smooth. The next thing that we need to learn, I need to get to clean this up here. I am cutting high on the piece, and that's really critical for spindle turning. The next thing that we need to learn is how to make V's. That's your next step. And V's lead to beads, and beads are our B, okay? And the trick to that is, it's very difficult to make a bead, but if you don't have your V's right, your beads are not gonna come out right. You have to get the V right. That sets the if you're trying to make them all the same, that sets the spacing. And also the angle is important because of the curvature that you're trying to make. If you're trying to get the same curve on both sides, you have to get the V right. And it takes some practice to do that. Now I need to lower my this just a little bit.
Do you ever start a V with your skew and then use a parting tool to kind of V it out more evenly?
No, because the parting tool is wide, and you want it to come to a point, and you won't be able to get that point. Might be able to. I guess I shouldn't say that. Conceptually,
diamond,
I think that you need to use the skew to do that.
I've done more V work with the skew than make for the Vs, but what I'm saying is one of my parting tools comes in nearly the perfect V.
I guess it depends on the type of parting tool you have,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, because some of the diamond-shaped ones, they're...
But we're learning basics here,
yeah.
And I'm trying to get you to use the skew.
Yeah.
And to get a feel for the tool so that you have a reference for other tools as you learn to use those. So, to do a V, now we use the bottom to do... to plane cut. But now we're going to use the top half of the tool to do the V's and the B's. You bring this in at the top, and you push in. You kind of rotate this in to get that. You don't want to go too deep, because if you do, then you're going to burn the wood. And it's better to do a shallow and a series of cuts than to make one big V out of one cut. Because then you might get a catch, because you don't have enough clearance for the tool. That's the simple part. Now I want to open it up some. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start with it 90 degrees to the center line of the blade. And I'm going to start it so that I get a groove to start. I'm going to twist it and then make my cut, make my angle. You can actually do it straight in. Let's see. Now, the first one's always easy. It's the next ones that are hard if you're trying to replicate. I'm just riding the tip down. Thank you. not so good. Straight in. Start knot form. Now I have my V's. I'm going to, I'm actually going to use the flat of that to clean the edges up because this one looks kind of rough. You can use this like a planer, but the trick to a planer is you want to be center line of your tool rest or below the center line. I'm going to clean this up a little bit. Alright. So that's the first part of making a bead. Now, the bead is, that's the one that's harder to make. And especially if you're trying to make it consistent. It took me 2 weeks of practicing before I could even get one to even half look like a bead. And so don't give up. Don't think that this is going to happen the first time you try, but keep practicing. Now, the trick to a bead is you have to do a coordinated movement. Mike Darlow, he compares it to driving a straight shift truck, sitting on a hill, and you got to make a turn. It's easy to know how to push in on the clutch, how to shift, and how to add gas, and then let off the clutch. But trick is getting all that coordination and timing together so that it works and is smooth. The same is true with turning the beads. It will be your challenge. Now, part of the problem is that if you're turning a 2-inch bead and you're making them really small, all of that action happens really quick. It happens really quick. And there's so many problems that you can create by doing that. Your shape, you may get a crown or a point. You may have one curve that's shallower than another. They just don't look right. But I think by making this wider, it helps you because you've got to get to the tangent point. You've got a flat up here that you're working toward. And if you mess up, you got more wood that you can keep on going and try to get a good turn. But I think it's easier to do it with this size of part than it would be with a 2-inch. When I do this, the movement to create a bead is you are going to rub the bevel, bring it down till it starts cutting, and you are going to roll your tool. At the same time, you're going to be moving. It's got to be moving along the tool rest. So you've got to move and turn. Then you have to move, turn, and push in. Okay? Now, the trick to all of this is knowing when to start, when to stop, when to go. And what I found for me is that my rate of turn has to be quicker when I get toward the end, and then my push is at the end. So you're learning this sequence of pushing and stroking. These are the kind of things that when you're learning and trying to develop this technique, you can play with these to try to understand what's going wrong. So, I want my tool rest up a little bit. When you start to make the bead, you don't cut it all off at once. You only do the corner there, maybe a couple of millimeters, and you're shaving it off, and you keep working your way until you get to the point that you're making a bead. And I'm cutting with this tip. No catch here. Now, what I would do if you're practicing this is to do the same side each time. Then come back and do the other side. Just to get a better feel for the tool. I don't feel like my tool is where I need it to be. So, I'm touching the bevel, starting to cut, I'm starting to turn, I'm sliding, I'm going up to the top, I increase my rate and push in. That's not pretty, but it's there. One more. You have to have a light touch here. You can't have a death grip on it. That's terrible. But we're going to keep going. I'll show you what you can do like in a minute. Ah, I didn't tell you. You raise the tool up too as you're doing this. That's one of the. So you got about four motions that you're going at one time. But what I'm really doing is I'm watching where my cut is and I'm watching the bevel of the tool as it's doing that to understand when to rotate and push in. Now you may notice me stop at a point there. It's because I have not slid far enough. So I stop and I start at that, I move my tool and start right there. So, the nice thing about the skew and turning beads, if you don't like what you've done, you can take away a lot of wood really quick. In fact, the C portion is learning to make a cove in the center. That looks bad. I might just tear it all up so you can't see it. Now I'm gonna fix it. a little better. This is basically what I want to show you today. I just want to show you to practice doing techniques and try to understand what you're doing, concentrate on what you're doing. And when you hear a new beginner trying to learn to turn, I think you should try to encourage them to practice some of these techniques to get a feel for their tool. So in the end, they become a proficient turner. And that's the goal. Thank you very much.
Good job.